All right. Well, hello, everyone. I'm Robert Franz, music director of the Windsor Symphony Orchestra, and I have three very special friends with me today to discuss an incredible piece that we are going to be performing for you at our February Masterworks. It is the Canadiana Suite by Oscar Peterson. And joining me on this call is Kelly Peterson, Oscar's widow, Thompson Egbo-Egbo, who will be the star of the show. He will be sitting at the piano performing this work. And Lance Anderson, who is the man who really brought it all together and made all of this happen for us here in Windsor. And Lance, I'd like to start with you because our audiences may indeed remember you because you were here a little less than a year ago when Shakira Saida performed at the Windsor Symphony Orchestra. You're the music director and pianist for her ensemble. And what was interesting is that backstage in passing between concerts, you said to me, "Hey, I've got this Oscar Peterson piece. Maybe you'd consider doing it at some point." Take it from there, Lance. How did this all come to be?
Well, the funny thing is, originally I'd asked Kelly if anybody had done an orchestral arrangement of the Canadiana Suite. And she didn't think so. And we actually looked it up and there hadn't been. There had been a big band arrangement by, Phil McConnell, Rob McConnell, sorry. And Rob had done a beautiful arrangement of it, but there hadn't been a orchestral arrangement. So we were just talking about that. And I asked her if she would mind if I would do one. And right at that point, the Okanagan Symphony, about a month later, called me and said they were looking for an orchestral arrangement of it. And I said, "Well, funny you should ask, because I was just talking to Kelly about this." And that's how it went. We went with, I got a commission from the Okanagan Symphony Orchestra to write the arrangement. And they were going to do a performance with Ballet Colonna. So there was ballet and the orchestra playing and the jazz trio. So that's really how my involvement started with the Canadiana Suite.
And Kelly, what does it mean to you to see a piece like this of Oscar's come to life in sort of this different way and sort of get legs of its own in kind of a way that maybe wasn't originally intended?
It's very gratifying to see that happen. And to, first of all, it's important to me to have Oscar's music performed. It's meant to be performed. And even though he's not here to play it, having others play it is very important. But to have it performed in a different context and with the symphony is also, as I said, very gratifying. It signals to me that Oscar's place as a composer is now becoming more recognized. And that's one of my main goals as the steward of his legacy, shall we say, to ensure that people are aware of the music he wrote and to have it performed and to have it be something that people will continue to look at and continue to want to perform for years and years and years.
Now, the work itself is, in effect, a travel guide. Each one of the movements in the work depicts a different aspect of Canada, which I assume, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, probably even dates back to his earliest days as a child when his father was a porter on the Canadian Pacific Railway, his sort of interest in this sort of huge landscape of Canada. We, and by we, I mean the sort of royal we of Lance Anderson, chose five movements to put together for our suite. Lance, tell us about these five movements that we're going to hear. I can remind you which ones they are if you'd like, but they're pretty spectacular.
Yeah, well, I mean, it starts with the Ballad from the East. Basically, Oscar went across the country from east to west. And what I love about them is that they're like it's an impressionistic view of just orally of what he felt about that. And some of them may have come from his father just telling stories about those areas. But certainly by that point, Oscar had traveled the country many times on concert tours and so on. So he'd seen them. But it wasn't, it's a funny thing, like with a genius like Oscar, he would just get this impression and it could have been immediate. It could have been a memory. And then this music would come to him. And the funny thing about, say, the Ballad of the East is that it's got a sort of you can hear the C in it, and not even as much as the piano. Once you scored that for orchestra, it starts sounding like La Mer. It has a lot of Ravel and Debussy kind of harmonies in it, and a lot of Gershwin-like harmonies as well. But once you score it, you feel the surge of the sea and stuff. So I found that with every one of his pieces, you know, the Laurentide Waltz, of course, is about the Laurentian Hills north of Montreal. And even to put that as a waltz is a funny kind of thing. Like it's a memory maybe of French Canadian waltzes or something that came to him. And he sort of, he would just grab things like that and go with it. Not that I don't think he really would have thought about it that much. He just would go with his impressions. And of course, Place Henri, which is his home neighborhood, that really was an expression of that vibrant neighborhood and everything that's going on. I mean, it's really going, as Thompson knows, it really moves. And it's got all that. It sort of reminds me of an American Paris, you know, it's got all those sounds of the street in the piece itself, you know. And I know we did March Past. Oh, of course, a Hogtown Blues. Hogtown Blues, an interesting piece. And it's a blues for Toronto, but it's got a sophistication to it. And I guess that's what he was trying to get across. This was a big city. This was a metropolitan city. And it's very dense harmony and very sort of intellectual for a blues, you know. And March Past, I guess, was from the Calgary Stampede. He was inspired by that. And he just has, you know, the sounds of like the parade and what was going on again in his mind. So...
Well, and I love that each one of these are so picturesque. I mean, that was what attracted me to the music as well.
Right.
In addition, is that this sort of interesting instrumentation, one that we don't normally put on our stage at the Windsor Symphony on a classical concert, and then it's jazz, piano, trio, and orchestra. And so for this performance, Thomas Egbo will be joining us, and we're really thrilled that you'll be making your debut with the Windsor Symphony for this concert. Now, Thompson, many people may know you through your recordings, like A New Standard and The Offering, recordings that you either made by yourself or with your trio, which, you know, you are an incredible artist, and all the music that I've heard of yours really is just, it's just sort of the spilling out of this music from you. It's really quite extraordinary. What is it like to delve into the mind and soul of someone like an Oscar Peterson and then think about bringing that music to life?
For me, it's exciting. I'm very humbled and nervous, in a good way, but definitely there's a couple of different elements of the nervousness, which is one, having to play the music, but two, also, you know, having to do it justice, but also just the connection of it being just a very Canadian piece. And I think, you know, sometimes you talk about Canadian culture and people are sort of just like, what is that? But this is it. Like, this is an opportunity to actually really show Canadian culture. And so for me, it's very exciting. You know, I tell people my very first jazz album was an Oscar Peterson album. It was him doing West Side Story. That was the first CD and someone ever gave me of any type of music. And so, you know, his music's always been a part of the collections that I have. And so, and it's funny because for me, you know, now, you know, we've got Spotify and all these, you know, streaming platforms, and you get to see the body of work people have created. And I always say to people, there's no, you know, it's not a coincidence that your favorite artists also have the biggest body of work. And wow, going through like the amount of stuff he has, I think it's just a testament to just one, how long he did it for, but just how prolific he was at getting the music out there. So it's I'm very excited about it. You know, I've even spoken to some of my former, I would say teachers or coaches, if you will, about, hey, this is coming down the pipe. And, you know, I'd love to get your eyes on, you know, what I'm going to do just to make sure that I've executed the best to my ability.
And I think there's something really humble and really special about what you just said. And I think it's true of almost all artists, that no matter what ilk you are, where you are in the process, we often take advice from others and still visit with mentors and try to really keep honing our craft. And that, I think, is why your performance of this piece, and I do want to thank Lance for introducing you to us, but I think that's why your performance of this piece will be so special, because you have such an ability to create from your soul, and then to understand the creator from that perspective, I think is really quite extraordinary. We're very much looking forward to that.
Yeah, thank you.
I would like to add something there, that Thompson, what you're saying is really you're doing your homework. And that's something that Lance will attest to, the fact that Oscar said that all the time to his students. And every great artist who I know has said the same thing about what process they have gone through in order to do what they've wanted to do. And it's all about studying. It's all about learning the catalog. It's all about really making sure that you're delving deeply and consulting with other people to get feedback. So it just signals to me how serious you are and makes me even happier. So I just wanted to say thank you. I wanted to say thank you for doing that.
Well, and some people say it's being an artist is 95% perspiration and 5% inspiration. That 95% might even be a little on the low side, because it really is exactly that we all have to just keep working, I mean, to hone your skill. So when those great moments happen, you can be ready for them. Mm-hmm.
You know, and I can hear Thompson's sort of being intimidated. Look, Oscar intimidated anybody who came to play.
he would deny that, Lance. He would deny that.
Oh yeah, he would deny. But look, nobody wanted to play. I saw, you know, all sorts of players shake when Oscar came in the room, and the people who played on the Oscar with Love CD, which Kelly produced, and I helped her with the music. This is people like Chick Corea and Ramsey Lewis. They were all in awe of playing anything by Oscar's, let alone playing his piano. So it's a big thing to look at. I feel for Thompson, because I mean, it's virtuoso playing, you know, yeah, at some of the highest level. And Oscar's improvisation on that level is really unparalleled in the world. I mean, there's just nobody who plays like that, you know, at those kind of tempos. And so it's a challenge. There's no getting around that.
But Lance, the truth is, from the top of the mountain, you get the best view.
Of course.
And so yeah, it is absolutely going to be a wonderful journey through this piece. Kelly, I do have a question for you that it has nothing to do with Canadiana, but it's something that's sort of been on my mind as I study other major artists, particularly Black artists who worked, you know, during the mid 20th century. How did Oscar deal with performing in so many places where he faced racism head on? I mean, today there is still obviously lots of racism in our business and in the world, but nothing compared to the just upfront version of it, I think, that many artists, and I talked to artists who've gone through this in the 50s, 60s, and 70s. How did Oscar face that?
That's an interesting question, in a certain way, difficult to answer, because facing it was just his nature. He, whatever challenges were presented to him in his way, he took them head on, really. And he was determined, no matter what, to just play better than anybody else, and to always play better, and each night to play better than he himself had played the night before. That was what he was focused on. Does it mean that the racism and all of that colored the experience? What a terrible choice of words. Sorry. It influenced the, you know, it's that, yes, having the atmosphere of racism certainly had an impact on the emotional state of all the musicians. But he was determined not to let that keep him from doing what he wanted to do. I also believe that because Oscar was working with Norman Granz, he had an advantage because Norman Granz was determined to break down racial barriers. And actually, the title of the biography of Norman is The Man Who Used Jazz for Justice. And that really is, it was Norman's intention to use the music to break down racial barriers. And in the South of the United States during the Jim Crow era, when segregation was everywhere, Norman refused to play to segregated audiences. And he made sure that everyone had a fair opportunity to buy seats in any section of the house and would not allow the theaters to be segregated. There were other things Oscar's, you know, when Oscar's trio with Ray Brown and Herb Ellis, in the South, one of the things that they couldn't avoid was segregated hotels. So there were the black hotels and the white hotels. Most of the musicians who were white would stay in the white hotels, but Herb Ellis always stayed with Oscar and Ray. Because he's, this is my group, you know, I'm going to be there. So I think it certainly had an impact on him. And in the music that he wrote, Hymn to Freedom, for example, and what he stood up for and what he spoke out against, as far as racism and discrimination go, Oscar was always speaking out against it. But he was not going to let that interfere with what he did musically. And instead,
which is probably an extraordinary statement.
Yeah, and probably part of it was kind of his, and Lance might giggle at this, but Oscar was pretty stubborn. And probably part of that was his absolute determination that he was going to show them. And he was just going to be the best and not let people say anything derogatory about what his performance was.
Well, this works, the Canadiana Suite by Oscar Peterson, is not only an extraordinary piece of music, but it fits in and works side by side with the other work on this program, which is the Symphony No. 3 by Florence Price, a rather famous African-American composer who was the first African-American female composer to have a work performed by a major orchestra, by the Chicago Symphony.
Oh, wow.
So we are thrilled and quite frankly honored to be able to share both of these pieces with our audience in Windsor. We feel like it's not only an important thing to do artistically, which is, by the way, at the top of the heap. These are incredible pieces of music. But we also think it's important that voices are heard that you might not typically see or hear in a concert hall. So I want to take a moment and just thank Thompson and Kelly and Lance, all of you, for all that you've done to make this happen for us here in Windsor. We are eternally grateful, and we cannot wait to hear the performance of the Canadiana Suite.
I'm excited as well. Thank you.
It's very exciting. Thank you for presenting it.
Thank you. Yeah. Really looking forward to hearing it because it's a fine orchestra and they'll do it justice. I know.
Thank you. All right, everyone. Thank you so much.